I think if we talk about medicine, there are two separate aspects. One is practice the art of medicine, the internist which they practice. Another is the art of craftsmanship, the surgery. Now if you divide this, now about the craftsmanship I will talk about. I won't talk about the art of internist medicine. If you see the art of craftsmanship, yes, India can equal to them. It is surgical. Now, a hair transplant, you don't have to go to America. You can get it done here as well and equally good. Now, where the craftsmanship is concerned, India can be considered a destination at a cheaper price. How the government would make it to get more foreign exchange? And I think if people don't go abroad, that is one way the government earns, because a money saved is money earned. So if people don't go abroad, like in my cardiac surgery, if I can prevent somebody going for bypass surgery abroad, I have earned the foreign exchange for the country. Now, if we look at the craftsmanship of medicine, yes, India can become, if we take it in a big way. But it is the government which will also support. But now then, if the question comes up, it then happens to a small subsector, which is super specialty. It cannot be the mass again. So I think there are some limitations, but we should not feel that it cannot be the hub of excellency.
That's well said. Dr. Khanna would like to add something on it.
I fully agree with Dr. Sudhanshu, absolutely well said. As craftsmen, we can excel, but it will be in limited sectors, super specialities. But unless the general standards of the masses are not improved from medical services point of view, becoming a hub will be difficult. Not impossible again, but needs a lot of work from the ground level itself.
You built up successful chain of hospitals, Cloud 9, in a lot of cities. So do you agree essentially what the panel discussion is happening, that India is a challenge actually when it comes to medical innovation?
No,
is it a challenge?
I think the whole world is looking at India as the health destination for the next century for three reasons. See, one is analytical software is a big thing being talked about in every country, and India being the software capital of the world, whole world is looking at how India is going to develop the analytical software. What does analytical software means? One is, if a person walks into your chamber, the software will tell you this fellow was born in such and such a place, and this fellow has a family history like this. He's potentially high risk for cancer, he's potentially high risk for diabetes, he's potentially high risk for hypertension. So start the preventive factors much earlier. So that is the software which we are looking at, and that's going to alert every doctor who is going to treat. And that is not finalized yet, and it's being into the developing process.
What is the percentage of patients you get from abroad in your entire hospitals here? All the hospitals?
No, ours is less than 1%. Now, there are three points which I wanted to
make. Do you look at your hospitals to emerge out as a global player?
Absolutely. The second point which I was going to take is, see, if you, for example, you look at Cloud 9, we deliver a normal delivery or a C-section for 60,000 rupees, which is about $1,000. The cost of the treatment, what we are offering at this stage, is much, much lower compared to the Western world, but the standard of care is much higher than that. So the whole world is looking at how we can achieve the same cost cutting, because healthcare is being unaffordable in Western countries because of the hiding costs. So we are market leaders in that. The third aspect which is going to be looked at India by the whole world is prevention, because now we have lifestyle diseases, obesity, hypertension, diabetes,
that's
cancer, for which we are controlling them, but we are not treating them. So we have a lot of systems, whether you take Ayurvedic, homeopathic, or Unani, whatever, Siddha medicine. So the whole world is looking at answers, whether lifestyle diseases can be treated by these rather than being controlling those things. So in those three areas, I think India is going to be a global power, provided we play the role correctly.
Yeah. Mudit, if I could ask you, because since you manage care group of hospital, did you face any challenges for the demonetization that happened? And did it reduce the number of patients coming to the hospital? And I discussed the other day with you. So what is your take on this? Audience would like to know about it.
So I think Demonetization is a very interesting story which is currently on the tip of everyone's tongue as well as on the tip of the fingers. Just to add to the point, Satya, regarding medical tourism while you were talking about. And I would agree partially with the panels which is here, and I would suggest that when you're looking at tourism per se, or you're looking at patients coming from abroad for treatment, you cannot look at just from the clinical aspect. You need to look at the understand the need of the patient per se in totality. And it looks, and you need to look at the infrastructure point of view right from his arrival to his whole experience of reaching the hospital. So many times I've had patients who have come from abroad, and half of them were quite terrified by the time they reached the hospital because they thought they are in some war-torn countries, because this is not the site they have been exposed to when they are abroad and getting treatment. So I think you cannot neglect by saying that I'm going to get the best clinical expertise, I've got the best software, so I'll become the destination for international patients. I think you need to look at the whole infrastructure aspect, where you need to look at services which you will offer, right from internet connectivity to the roads, to the service levels, to what kind of nursing, etc. you will provide. Coming to the point you have asked about demonetization, yes, I think there has been an effect which has happened across the board on the service industry, where we have seen that there was a dip in terms of both the number of patients which had happened in the outpatient clinics at certain places, as well as exchange of transactions.
Has it come as a huge shock to you when you heard on 8th of November?
I'm sorry?
Did it come as a huge shock to you when Prime Minister announced on 8th of November?
Absolutely. I think when the Prime Minister made that announcement, it was a shock across.
And did you make some arrangement how to tackle it?
Immediately, no, because we went back to our drawing boards and we all worked out. We looked at how we can make it easier for the patients in terms of, so we talked to the banks and we created a provision where patients who were admitted on the 9th of 7th and 8th who were there and they had to make their payments. So we facilitated with the banks for their exchange of old currency and stuff. And then we started using credit cards and we started using other modalities like Paytm and stuff. Yeah. So we actually giving free software, downloading. So all these activities were done by the hospitals across.
In fact, I often get surprised, even shocked when I see, why do hospitals, it is to you, Debraj, actually, although you have just started your clinic, and I know, I wish you very best, why do hospitals or any major clinics, they prefer cash over plastic? Is it obsession with the cash that takes you there, or what is that factor?
No, I don't think that's true anymore. When we say cash, we don't necessarily mean cash. We mean cash versus TPA. What we mean is whether it's a patient who's being paid by insurance, whether it's a self-paying patient.
No, this is not individually, but I'm generally talking.
Yeah, yes. In general also, cash, when right. Surgeons are saying it's a cash patient, it doesn't mean that someone's actually paying the hard notes. It means that it's a self-paying patient vis-a-vis a patient who's being paid by TPA. That's the difference. The elective surgery versus...
I'll yes. agree with him. Satya, at any point of time, if the option is given to you that the money will be transferred to your credit card vis-a-vis, it will be given in hand to you, it's a general tendency. People would always prefer to work in
it
cash.
It is taxable. One. It becomes taxable. Yeah.
And secondly, in healthcare industries, currently the phenomena is such that a lot of work is happening towards the credit side. And we have a lot of challenges, especially with certain credit agencies, which are not TPAs, but government-based programs or corporate-based programs, where the return on the money usually takes about more than 90 days, though it is promised 90 days. As a result, the cash flow cycles becomes very, very challenging to handle, and you can't go and take loans on that, and that would further hike up the cost of delivery to the healthcare. So these are important issues. That's why anyone would prefer a 90-day or a 30-day or a cash, which I think across the board, anyone would be more than happy with. It's so not healthcare per se.
Yeah, so let me take to, you could add, maybe.
I just wanted to build on this. The methodology of payment is one important criteria. There was a study done by BCG about a year back to find out critical success factors for hospitals. And the number one criteria there, why people choose a hospital, was reputation of a doctor. And second and third was not facility and infrastructure and other things that people talk about. It was basically accuracy of billing and transparency about what has been charged. And therefore, it is very important
So you are angry with the establishment which is prevailing now?
No. The point I am trying to make is that in addition to having great doctors in a hospital, what is equally important is to have good systems and transparency and accuracy of billing.
Which is missing.
Which is currently missing and which leads to a lot of dissatisfaction among the patients and their relatives.
Yeah.
So typically what happens is that the treatment is complete, the time for checkout has come, but it can take hours and hours and hours for that bill to be complete and check to be made or credit card to be presented.
Yes.
So that was the point.
That's
right.
Let me take you to the young doctor, Dr. Manan. I will ask you, do you think public-private partnership in healthcare could make a difference? To Dr. Manan, yeah. Do you think public-private partnership in healthcare could make a difference?
I suppose so. Public-private partnership is required because, as mentioned, we cannot leave everything to the government as well. I mean, there is a very big need for such kind of a partnership to take place. I would also like to address the point of tourism because that was a very interesting topic. I don't know how many of you all are aware, but the entire state of Kerala has the maximum amount of revenue in tourism coming from Ayurveda. So many people from across the world, they don't have any option for Ayurveda except to come to India. Today, if someone, as Dr. Debraj Shom was saying, people come from the SAR countries, from the Middle East, because the quality of India is a little bit superior. But why would someone come from Europe? Why would someone come from the USA? Because it's too far. The traveling cost will itself be a big factor. And suppose if they are coming, it is only because of cost. But a lot of people do not have solutions available in allopathy. A lot of solutions are available in Ayurveda. For example, the government of India has just officially released a medicine for diabetes. An Ayush ministry recommended. So a lot of people suffer from diabetes. They don't have these options. So tourism and Ayurveda go hand in hand.
So that's a fair good point. So to, just quickly.
Just one point about PPP, Satya. I have had the privilege of being associated with a hospital, perhaps the first hospital in the country, which was built on a PPP model, Seven Hills Healthcare. While I think it's a great idea, and also it links back to the question that you had asked me earlier.
So is it about a success or a disaster?
About excess deficit.
Is it a success?
I'm answering both. If excess deficit needs to be addressed, government needs to play a very important role. Because I think only private sector cannot address that issue. Coming back to the success and failure of a PPP model, what is important is for both sides to understand the obligations very well and with a certain level of transparency, ensure that those obligations are not subject to interpretations which can keep changing on a daily basis. And that is where PPP model in healthcare at least, and I think it will be true for other sectors as well, has not succeeded. Because my interpretation of what the contract says versus your interpretation of what the contract says can differ, and it can differ dramatically. And that is why PPP has not been a success so far, at least in healthcare. And therefore, what is important is to understand the letter and spirit of the contract and do not be guided by interpretation, which keeps changing on a daily basis.
Sekhar, if you could quickly add what is...
Yes, I like to add on that. Well, I am a firm believer of this PPP model because I feel that, but in this case, it is my opinion that government should only have the regulatory role. Government should be in a position to regulate the entire industry, but it should leave the delivery of the care to the private players, because we have proved in last 70 years that we are inefficient in delivering the services to our masses. Still, there are people in our country who die just because they don't have money to pay to the doctors. And that is, it's the saddest part of our country.
So that's
that people
sort of
die
time,
because they don't have money to pay.
We are sort of time to start. So I would like to give final word to Dr. Bhattacharya. What is the message that you would like to give it to the audience and to India that healthcare is a very sensitive subject? Let us not play on it. Let's innovate. And let's do something different and be not pessimist. I know you are a very good optimist. So what is the message you would like to give? With this, actually, I would like to end. probably this will be the takeaway from this panel discussion.
I think the first thing is to keep your mind open. At no stage feel yourself inferior or let down. And do not depend entirely on the government. The government has many other things to do. Private sectors must take the responsibility. We have taken so much from the society. It is our duty to give back to the society. And giving back to the society means that we ourselves form some bodies, some associations, and keep looking at the healthcare in an open way. Blaming government, I don't think that we will achieve anywhere. And I therefore feel that all the private players who have come up into this healthcare are doing a fantastic job. People criticize for profitability and will tell about this, put it as commercial and all these things. But we must realize that they are expanding and they will also help people who are innovating in the newer drugs. I feel that there is a tremendous scope for medicine in this country, and we are gifted people who can do a very, very good craftsmanship. And I think we should have a more introspection to ourselves rather than blame the government.
So we should have more introspection rather than blame the government is the takeaway from the point. With this, I come to the conclusion of the panel discussion, which had a wonderful debate on this. I'm really privileged to have with all the doyens of the medical profession to be with me. Thank you, Dr. Khanna. Thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya. Thank you, Dr. Kishore. Thank you, Debras. Thank you, Budit. Thank you, Anand. Thank you, Sekhar. Thank you. I remember everybody's name personally, actually. Thank you, Manan. Thank you, Rusi, for having me here. That brings to the end of this panel discussion. Thank you for watching this telecast, and thank you very much. Please tell me. Can we have the mementos, please, here? So I'll just come there, no problem. This is for you. This is for you. So this is for you, sir. This is for you, Dr. Kishore. So. Manan, this is for you, the young doctor. All courtesy creative awards, and Prasanth is there, so thank you very much for being there. Yes, this is for you. This is for the facial plastic surgeon, so it's a huge round. And this is for you, Rusi. So can we have a group round, Janya? Yes. So KK, get ready for the next round. We're coming out now. Yeah. So can you stand up there? We'll have it. Without you, this is incomplete. So I think you have to take some pain for it. Sorry. Thank you very much. This has been a wonderful evening. And let us give a huge round of applause to these doctors who are with us.
Please, sir.
So,
thank you.
Thank you. Yes, nomination, buddy.
So after that very informative and riveting panel discussion, we'd promised you when we started this Pharma Leaders Summit earlier on in the afternoon that the evening will conclude with the very prestigious Pharma Leaders Power Brand Awards. Here we are, the Pharma Leaders Power Brand Awards. The Pharma Leaders Awards is an annual competition designed to honor excellence in the healthcare sector through a comprehensive methodology to motivate, boost, and support the innovations and the innovators in the pharmaceutical industry and the healthcare industry, giving the winners the right recognition that they deserve. Pharma Leaders has been at the forefront of highlighting the crucial issues that general public face, healthcare faces, and pharmaceuticals face, and bring them to the forefront. In fact, with digitalization and technology moving forward, Pharma Leaders has been at the forefront of organizing several forums and also honoring several leaders who have taken several steps forward in these fields.
They embarked on their journey in the year 1999 while the healthcare industry was a fast emerging industry as a rising force. Through in a very unorganized way at that point of time, they are the first to introduce meaningful dialogue amongst the professionals of the pharmaceutical industry in the form of summits and conclaves like these. They are also the first to introduce the healthcare awards, also known as Pharma Leaders Awards, to recognize the shining stars of Indian healthcare industries.
The mission of Pharma Leaders is to be a world leader at recognizing, honoring, fostering innovation innovators in the field of healthcare and pharmaceuticals to create, support, and make a positive impact in the world. Now, to take you through the methodology of how the winners were actually selected, my invite on stage, Satya Brahma, who will take you through the entire methodology and the processes of the award winners and how they were actually selected. Satya, please.
Let's have a huge round of applause for Satya Brahma.
So I'm often coming to the stage, but this is a very crucial stage where I need to actually discuss with you. I need to tell you that how we arrive at the process of selecting the winner actually. Many people might be thinking that how we pick up this final six. So there is a process which goes on. We have a team of reporters that we send out to various associations. We try to find out that who is doing well and who is not doing well. And if somebody is there in the remote part of the country where the message is not going to clear and that is outside the purview of the media glare, this is the place where we find out the talent. And you will see today some of the shining stars of the Indian pharma and healthcare industry who are out from the public glare are getting to be noticed out here. Without taking much time, I would like to show the process through a video which I'm going to start now.
Established by the illustrious healthcare communication media, Pharma Leaders, the flagship healthcare brand of mainstream media network 7 Media Group, Pharma Leaders is arguably the pioneer in healthcare communications and Asia's most influential healthcare media. The objective of the Pharma Leaders recognition is to honor the mind of the leader and be a part of the celebration. Pharma Leaders Power Brand Awards celebrate the accomplishments and spirit of the healthcare innovations by recognizing the extraordinary achievements of individuals and companies in the areas of best healthcare practice, governance, research and entrepreneurship. Ladies and gentlemen, our greatest strengths have been our ability to spot innovations and value the spirit of pioneering efforts, our bold willingness to defy conventional norms and solve issues that people consider tough, our confidence in the future and refusal to be bound by the present. Our motto has been to be endlessly positive and eager to tackle problems, to address the needs and unlock the potential of healthcare innovations and innovators. Ladies and gentlemen, Pharma Leaders do what others fail to do: recognize and reward innovation,
encourage experiments and pilots and create a non-punitive environment. Over the last one decade, Pharma Leaders Power Brand Awards symbolize the persistence and excellence in inspiring the region's drive to remain in the forefront of innovation, creativity and ingenuity in the healthcare global innovations by recognizing and honoring innovators and defining excellence. It unwaveringly continues its passionate journey of celebrating the indigenous achievements of leaders and organizations that have made significant difference to their profession, industry and to healthcare progress regionally and globally. By focusing on merits, innovations, rich healthcare leadership, rewarding best practices and recognizing outstanding contributors, Pharma Leaders Awards put the spotlight is on those leaders and organizations which have really excelled, as well as the stories that they have created to build a stronger and healthier India. The institution Pharma Leaders honors the principles and prominent leadership of the healthcare global leaders, decision makers and various organizations that are path breakers of leadership excellence. It focuses on the remarkable achievements and noteworthy influence of the pharma leaders, and also throws light on the pivotal role played by the iconic healthcare leaders in leading the healthcare transformation to the threshold of the new world. It aims to make a quantum leap and a comprehensive approach in the performance of all those who have contributed immensely to make their vision a great success and who were able to take the maximum advantage of the opportunities available to them regionally and internationally, and making the best out of those opportunities. We are happy today when we notice the rise of companies in healthcare to honor the achievers. In the early stage of our momentous journey, we recognized the veterans and legends who are now no more, but our spirit of leadership are still reverberating in the reception of companies. Late Dr. Parvinder Singh of Ranbaxy, who built India's first MNC, Dr. Anji Reddy of Dr. Reddy's Labs, Mr. Indravadan A. Modi of Cadila, Mr. Jagdish Saxena of Elder Pharmaceuticals, or the former Drug Controller General of India, DCGI, Dr. M. Venkateswaralu, are the few notable names. The current thespian legendary pharma leaders who are responsible for building the India image, like Dr. Yusuf K. Hamid of Cipla, Dr. Habil Kuraikiwala of Work Hard, Mr. Samprada Singh of Alkem Laboratories, Dr. D.B. Gupta of Lupin, or Mr. Suresh Kare of Indoco Remedies are in the list of Pharma Leaders Winners Library. Pharma Leaders Magazine, India's first opinion-based and research-driven bi-monthly magazine, was facilitated more than 500 companies and has created world-class platform in the form of summit where discussions are on burning issues. The historic pharmaceutical leadership summits has been addressed by some of the crucial topics of great significance by the industry leaders, policy makers, academia, etc. The defining moments with pharma leaders attempt to focus year after year is to enhance the communication of the industry and the government. Pharma Leaders Business Leadership Awards has been presented to the top performers and shining stars of the Indian healthcare industry year after year. The aim is to encourage and motivate the pharma leaders to achieve greater success in coming days. These set of awards are determined by a credible award mechanism under the supervision of prominent juries. Ladies and gentlemen, Pharma Leader Jury arrive at the final six nominees for their leadership position in their respective fields after a scrutiny and a detailed research by a team of researchers and experts that are followed year after years at the Pharma Leaders Annual Award editions, thereby making the process very credible and transparent. We are often asked by the nominees as they are surprised when they see their list of final countdown. Pharma leaders believe in initiatives that are path-breaking, innovative and offbeat. We don't need to please the established leaders, rather we challenge the status quo. We recognize leaders who we make the system and establishment proud. And our attempt is to chase after leaders who are unique, dynamic, aggressive, and speak the language that we love. Change agent. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be wondering how we choose you. The answer is that we sent out a team of healthcare research experts, analysts, and industry experts on a global hunt for companies and entrepreneurs achieving dual excellence in two critical areas, customer value and growth success. Put another way, we were searching for a woman healthcare leader that not only had a vision to make the company a unique and distinctive, but to use strategies, insights to achieve growth above the industry average. We asked our global network of consultants and analysts to monitor, screen, and analyze creative practices within their regions. We spoke to industry peers. We vetted our findings with an independent board of directors. At the end of our process, we select one leader standing out from the rest. Our attempt is to bring the leaders and companies who have been working remarkably well in tough conditions without financial aids in their respective field, without any public recognitions and media glare. This is the area of innovations where Pharma Leaders Power Brand Awards make the difference, said Satya Brahma while announcing the names of the winners. Ladies and gentlemen, hold your breath, pause in silence. We are about to surprise you and give you something that you have waited for years. Yes, here are the nominations for the 9th Annual Pharmaceutical Leadership Summit and Business Leadership Awards 2016.
That was really a very, very
impactful
video on how the award winners for tonight were chosen. I entirely agree with you. Now, as with every year, we've got a very eminent personality who's agreed to grace this very illustrious evening and this very glittering evening as the chief guest. And I request Satya to introduce the chief guest for the evening, please.
You have the paper. So we're very pleased to have with us Dr. Mukesh Batra, considered to be the pioneer in homeopathic medicines in India, the man who built the homeopathic medicines without having anything in the pocket, the person who valued ethics as one of the biggest weapon to challenge the establishment. Years after years, research went on. And Dr. Mukesh Batra's journey of 40 years. Today, you find everywhere Dr. Batra's products. Homeopathy in India was neglected, actually. Nobody knew what homeopathy was all about. He is the main person who brought it to the fame, to the world map, what homeopathy is all about. Dr. Mukesh Batra, many of you might not be aware also, that he's also into the social activities. He is a singer, he's also a painter, and moreover, he's also a very good human being. I am very fortunate to have with me Dr. Mukesh Batra. Can I have you, sir, please, on the stage to give her the honors, please?
Thank you very much, Dr. Batra. It's a great honor to have you with us.
And let's kickstart the award ceremony.
All right, yes, let's get the awards going. The first award for the evening, the biotech leader of the decade, Mr. C.L. Rathi, Managing Director, Advanced Enzyme Technologies Limited. Mr. Rathi, please.
Let's have a look at the winners in the very prestigious set of individual jury categories. And the winners are Biotech Leader of the Decade. And the winner is Mr. Chandrakant Lakshminarayan Rathi, Managing Director, Advanced Enzyme Technologies Limited.
Mr. Rathi, if you can come forward, please.
Good evening, everybody, and Jai Gurudev to all of you. Well, as you know, behind every success, there are hundreds of people who support your dreams. In fact, they take the burnt. The leader doesn't take that much burnt. A persistence is the only major quality for a leader. But actual work has been done by my more than 600 employees, now more than 30,000 stakeholders. And whole purpose of our company has been to provide side effect free healthcare. So enzymes, although you know all the drugs are given to accelerate some enzyme action in the body or to retard some enzyme action in the body, and whereas the enzyme can become a side effect free therapy along with probiotic and prebiotic, that is the way work which we have been doing for last over 50 years now, predominantly in US and more than 55 countries we export today, and we do cover healthcare along with nutrition, along with animal feed because it is also part of human health, and then also the processing areas of agro-based products. I sincerely appreciate Ms. Satya Brahma and entire juries for recognizing the work which we have been doing for over 5 decades. My father started the journey since 1958 with first enzyme plant making papain, and later we brothers took up the work of fermentation based enzyme, and that has become our sole mission. Thank you so much for appreciating. I sincerely appreciate, and we look forward to further delivering more and more solutions to the humanity. Thank you so much.
Congratulations, Mr. Rathi. Congratulations.
And it's time to move on to the next winner for Best CSR in Pharma in 2016. And the winner
Best CSR in Pharma 2016, and the winner is Work Hard Foundation.
Let's applaud for Work Hard Foundation.
Ladies and gentlemen, I thank Mr. Satya Brahma and the organizers of this summit for giving this award to Work Hard Foundation for the best CSR. And Work Hard Foundation was formed around 8 years ago, and we have 400 full-time warriors. Our employees, we call them the warrior. So warrior means to have a fighting spirit to help the underprivileged community. And our main, we have 10 programs in Work Hard Foundation. And our flagship program is the mobile medical vans. And we are operating 95 mobile vans across 15 states of India. And a typical mobile van has doctor, pharmacist, and driver. It has medicine and diagnostic. And it covers 25 villages every week. And in 1 year, 25,000 patients get free primary health care. So through these 95 vans, we gave the free primary healthcare to 2 million patients last year. And they go to the village where the Indian villages don't have the primary health. So there's a shortage of primary health in the villages. Besides this, we have participated in Swachh Bharat Abhiyan mission of the Prime Minister, and we built 1,000 community toilets in the rural schools. We have an e-learning program where in 400 schools we installed e-learning. And so this award is to thank the warriors who have worked so hard for this. And they are governed by four values, that is the best. B is beneficent, service to poor. E is excellence, quality first. S is speed, one step ahead. And T is trust, to deliver on the commitment. So I thank you for this award, and thank you.
Congratulations to Work Hard Foundation.
The next award for the evening is the Healthcare Leader of the Decade. The award goes to
Healthcare Leader of the Decade. And the winner is Mr. Rajendra Gupta.
Projects to say and companies to tell about. I have been working in healthcare policies for over a decade, and I think it's too early to get this award. But as always, I keep saying, I have got things that I don't deserve, and I think it's the love and affection of people around who gave me this award. I still get reminded of a quote that my dear friend in politics, Dr. Murali Manohar Joshi, says, "A man rises to his level of incompetence." It applies to me. Thank you so much.
Very modest of you to say that, Rajendra. Congratulations, Rajendra.